Hello students, in this video we will study the poem Elegy Written in a Country Churchyard by Thomas Gray. As the first word in the title suggests that the poem is an elegy, so let's find out what is an elegy. Elegy is a poem, it is a kind of poem in which we find a formal and sustained lament. Means the entire poem is meant to grieve over the death of a particular person, and that particular person might be a relative, it might be a friend or some public figure as well. And such poems usually end in the feeling of consolation, where the mourner gradually comes over the sense of grief and he accepts the truth. It is not only a lament on the death of a particular person. In the broader sense, the term also includes the serious reflective poems on the general themes of mortality, loss and change. So an elegy is basically a mournful and sorrowful poem. Now let's talk about the context of the poem. Though the poem was partly inspired by the death of the poet's friend Richard West, who died in 1742, but the major inspiration for writing this poem the poet gets when he visits a country churchyard at Stoke Poges, and there he saw simple, unattended graves of rustics, rural people there, and it prompted him to reflect on the subject of death and longing for remembrance after death. So that reflection came out in the form of this poem. Now let's read some important and often quoted stanzas from the poem. The first stanza goes like this: the curfew tolls the knell of parting day, the loving herd winds slowly over the lea, the ploughman homeward plods his weary way and leaves the world to darkness and to me. So this first stanza describe the setting, the atmosphere for writing this poem. As we know that the poem was written in a country churchyard, where the poet Thomas Gray witnesses, he sees the humble conditions of the graves there, and he is forced to reflect on the poor existence, simple existence, and the obscure destiny of these rural peoples, and which forces him to reflect on the general theme of death. So now let's have a look at some unfamiliar words from the this stanza. The curfew. The curfew is the evening bell which was rung in England of Middle Ages, announcing the end of the day and announcing the people to put out fires in their houses and retire for night for safety purposes. The knell, it is another kind of bell which is rung at the death and funeral of somebody. In the second line, the lea. The lea is the grass area for cattle to graze, or we can say it is a meadow. In the third line, plods. It is to walk with heavy steps. Thus, the stanza can be interpreted like this. The curfew tolls. The poet hears the ringing of the evening bell, which is like the death bell of parting day, of closing day, the day which is soon going to be over. The loving herd, and at this time the poet can see the herd of cattle coming back through the lea, and the farmer too is walking back to his home, towards his home, on the weary way, on the path which is tired. It is the ploughman who is tired, but the poet has used the adjective weary before another noun, that is way. So here the poet has used the poetic device of a transferred epithet. In the fourth line, the poet says, and leaves the world to darkness and to me. So he says every creature around him is returning back to their respective habitat. It is only the poet who is left behind in this darkness, and the darkness which is soon going to cover the entire world around him, leaving him to think about, to reflect on, to contemplate on the idea of death. The poet further writes that beneath those rugged elms, that yew tree shade where heaves the turf in many a mouldering heap, each in his narrow cell forever laid, the rude forefathers of the hamlet sleep. So the poet says that each rude forefather, each ancestors of this small village was lying forever, he was buried forever, and where was these forefathers of this small village were buried? Beneath those rugged elms, beneath those wild and roughly grown elm trees and that evergreen yew tree shade. And what was the condition of the graves? Where heaves the turf? He says the graves were like a raised heap of earth, and they were in a very mouldering, in a very decaying and rotting condition. So the poet here describes the lowly and neglected and chaotic condition of the graves in that country churchyard. These two stanzas which now I am going to read are very important and universal in their appeal. So let's read them. Let not ambition mock their useful toil, their homely joys and destiny obscure, nor grandeur hear with a disdainful smile the short and simple annals of the poor. So the poet here, using abstract nouns, ambition and grandeur, indirectly addresses and criticizes the ambitious people and people of high rank and importance, that they should not make fun of the poor, they should not make fun of their useful toil, the hard work that they perform in the fields, that they do in the fields to grow crops for us, their homely, their simple joys, and the fact that they are destined to live and die obscurely, nor grandeur here with a disdainful smile, nor these people of high rank should listen here with hostility the short and simple, unremarkable history of these poor people. And he explains in the next stanza that why these people should not look down upon this short and simple story of the poor, because the boast of heraldry, the pomp of power, and all that beauty and all that wealth ever gave awaits alike the inevitable hour. The paths of glory lead but to the grave. The poet says that all the big talks of being born in a rich family and all the display of power and all the favors and attention we enjoy because of being beautiful or being rich, all these things, heraldry, power, beauty, wealth, all these things await alike without any discrimination. They wait for that inevitable hour. They wait for that unavoidable hour, that is the death. They are all equally and without discrimination awaiting for that ultimate truth, that is death. And in the last line, he says, the paths of glory lead. The paths of glory are going towards the grave. The paths of glory are taking us only towards our grave. Thus, the poet says that death spares none. And death does not discriminate between rich and poor, and these worldly things, heraldry, power, beauty, and wealth are not the worth to be proud of. So, this is the explanation of some of the stanzas, and the rest of the poem I will discuss in next video. Thank you.